coming up, goes R goes for launch.
Shenzhou 11 returns to Earth.
Ben's got an interview with John Powell of JP Aerospace.
Stay tuned. Tomorrow begins right now.
Welcome to Tomorrow. As always, I am Carrie Ann Higginbotham, and joining me shortly will be Space Mike and Jared in studio. But first, I want to make sure that I give a huge welcome and thank you to our Patreon Premier members. These are the people who have given us $10 or more per segment, or for this segment of this particular episode. They, of course, get access to our Slack channel, which is always very interesting and always very entertaining and sometimes a little bit weird, but that's okay. So, but I hope you guys are enjoying that, because we're all enjoying that very much. So thank you, thank you, thank you. Really appreciate the support. It's super, super awesome, warm, fuzzy feelings that we get from you guys every week. Those are those people. In any case, camera switch, as I am still not used to, but that's okay. Like I said, I am Carrie Ann. I am joined, of course, by Jared and Mike. And first off, Mike, we've got a couple of launches that we need to get to right off the bat. If you wouldn't mind, go ahead and giving me all the info on that so we can get started, yeah?
Absolutely. First off, we have an Ariane 5 launch, which launched 4 Galileo satellites. Let's check out the footage.
Allumage Vulcan. Allumage des UAP, décollage.
This launch took place at 1306 Coordinated Universal Time on Thursday, which was November 17th from French Guiana. And as I said, it launched 4 Galileo satellites, which is for the European GPS system, specifically Galileo 15, 16, 17, and 18, headed to geosynchronous orbit. And interestingly, this was the 75th consecutive successful launch of the Ariane 5 rocket. So congratulations to Ariane Space and the European Space Agency for this successful launch.
And we had another one, yeah? There was at least two. There was a Soyuz, right?
Yes.
Yeah, actually on the same day, Thursday, November 17th. This was a Soyuz FG launch, which launched the next crew to the International Space Station. Let's check out the launch. This launch took place at 2020 Coordinated Universal Time, and this was from the Baikonur Cosmodrome. And this shot is just beautiful, the illumination of the smoke there from the engines that I love. Mm-hmm. This was carrying Soyuz MS-03 spacecraft for Expeditions 50 and 51, and carried Oleg Novitsky, Thomas Pesquet, and Peggy Whitson for their stay at the International Space Station. So I'm glad that launch went successfully as well.
I think the really fun thing about watching the two launches kind of not side by side, but sort of back to back like that, is that you get to see the huge differences between the different vehicles, because there's some things that just sort of launch right off of the pad. Good one, Carrie Ann.
Take off.
Oh, goodness. But there are some that just sort of that seem to go way faster than others. And I always find that to be interesting like that.
It is.
Jared, you've got some interesting stuff going on with the goes. I always say Gozer, and it only because it reminds me of Ghostbusters.
Yes.
And there is no Dana now, only Zool. But tell me more about it's goes R. Is that correct?
Goes R.
Okay,
yes.
Perfect. It and looks like Gozer, though.
It does look like Gozer, but it's goes R.
Yes. All right.
And it's going to be the first of the newest generation of weather satellites to be launched into geostationary orbit. It is absolutely massive. And we're actually only a few hours away from it launching. It's going to be launching at 2242 Coordinated Universal Time with a 60-minute launch window on an Atlas V in the 541 configuration. So 5-meter payload fairing, 4 solid rocket boosters, and a single-engine Centaur upper stage. In other words, it's a really big satellite that's being launched up there. Now, GOES stands for Geostationary Operational Environmental Satellite. Basically, what it does is it looks at the weather here on Earth, mm-hmm. and it does so through multiple means. It does so through visible light, infrared light, and in addition to that, it's also going to have sensors that will look at things like lightning, and also sensors that will look at space weather in situ while it's in orbit around the Earth.
In situ.
So that means actually in space.
Okay,
so it's
going to
study the environment in space.
Just checking.
Right there. So yes, no, that's perfectly fine. and this is the first of what will be four new weather satellites over the next decade. So we're all very excited about this because more data means better weather predictions, which means better forecasting, which means you won't get caught without your umbrella or with the top up when it's a nice sunny day. So, so really looking forward to this launch.
That will be very cool. Although here in Southern California, we never have weather, it seems like. So
whatever that is.
All right. So in any case, and so somebody in the chat room was saying, all right, so Soyuz launched. So we had a couple of people. We know that some people came back down from Earth. So how many people are in space right now? And there's actually a howmanypeoplearenspacerightnow.com. And it says that there's 8. But Mike, you want to tell us about the people who just left space recently?
Yeah, that probably hasn't been updated because 2 of those 8 people came home yesterday on Friday. And what we're talking about is the Shenzhou 11 crew who were up at the Tiangong 2 space station. And we actually have footage of their undocking. And this footage is actually a bit unprecedented because we get some angles of stuff that I have never actually seen before. But this undocking that you're seeing right now on screen actually happened on Thursday. And they landed on Friday at 5:51 coordinated universal time in Inner Mongolia, which has really similar terrain to the steppes of Kazakhstan that the Russians land in with their Soyuz capsule.
So
on board the Shenzhou 11, though, were Jing Haipeng and Chen Dong. They spent 32 total days in space. And the next mission to the Tiangong 2 space station will be the Tianzhou 1 cargo spacecraft in April. Now, what you're seeing on screen is the orbital module floating away from the spacecraft. I've never seen that before with the Russian. And then this picture right there, what you're seeing floating away is the descent capsule. That has the 2 taikonauts on board it right there. And then just some more amazing footage that we have from this. They were actually able to capture it re-entering the atmosphere. That's just amazing.
Wow.
Even in color, that we're able to see that. That's something I've never seen before, even with old Apollo stuff. Now, the landing itself, there wasn't a whole lot of footage of that. We get this little animation of the parachute deploying. But everything was successful. The 2 taikonauts were recovered and seemed to be in good condition. And everything is moving well with that. So I'm really happy about this mission. They were able to do a lot more science on this mission than they previously were with Tiangong 1. I kind of relate it to almost like elementary school science experiments they did on Tiangong 1. So they were able to do a lot more with this mission, and they did a lot of pre-planning and pre-setting up for future missions. They hope to use Tiangong 2 for hopefully quite a few more missions before moving on to their Mir-class space station. So right now, though, there's only 6 people in space.
Gotcha. All right. Well, good to know. I'm sure that'll be updated shortly. I don't know who actually takes care of that one, but it's great because it's how many people are in space right now.com. And so it's kind of easy to remember. You can even pretty much Google it and it'll come right up.
Yeah.
And in any case, so Jared, you were talking to me about Mercury.
Yes.
And
one of my favorite planets.
Yeah, is it?
Actually, yeah.
Oh.
Yeah.
And we didn't go over that part.
Yeah, and Mercury's got this very interesting feature on it that was just recently spotted in data from the MESSENGER mission. Mm-hmm. So MESSENGER is a definite backronym because it stands for Mercury Surface Space Environment Geochemistry and Ranging. So,
oh, yes.
Try to say that about 20 times.
As opposed to Gozer.
If you can. Yeah. As well, we're just all over the place with the references today. Now, they have found what appears to be a massive valley on Mercury. It's 1,000 kilometers long, 400 kilometers wide, and 3 kilometers deep. Now, something interesting about Mercury's geology is that unlike here on Earth, where we have multiple tectonic plates that are constantly in motion, on Mercury, there was one tectonic plate. And it's no longer geologically active in terms of what you would see here on Earth.
Okay.
But as Mercury cooled down, that single tectonic plate around it shrunk in size. So that causes these really weird sort of what we could call scarps, or basically areas where material falls out and exposes like a cliff. out of it. And that is how we think that this massive valley, which is in the data that we can see here, that reddish area, this is how we think that that valley ended up there. And it's sort of similar to the structures that we call lithospheric buckling here on Earth. And that is some very interesting geology happening out on Mercury.
So- Destructor 1701 in the chat room is saying, how did they miss that? Yeah, how did we not come across this before? Yeah.
Well, we didn't come across this before because there were certain parts of Mercury that actually hadn't been seen before the Messenger mission.
Okay.
Because before Messenger, the only mission that went to Mercury was Mariner 10. And it flew by Mercury a couple times. And Mercury has this interesting thing where for every two orbits, it goes through 3 days in rotation, if I'm remembering correctly. Okay. Or it's every three orbits, 2 days.
Sure.
One of those. But it's a very interesting type of slow rotation that doesn't quite match its orbit very well. Mm-hmm. So because of that, when Mariner 10 flew by, it was not able to image the entire planet.
Okay.
It was only able to image parts of the planet, Mercury. Sure. So once Messenger went into orbit around Mercury, that definitely allowed us to start taking images of the entire surface, which is where this was found. This was found in an area that had not been seen previously before by Mariner 10. So that's why we just now discovered this really huge feature there, is because this was in the missing part of Mercury.
Okay. So. Interesting. Mm-hmm. All right.
Yeah. Very interesting.
Yeah. Okay. And Mike, talking about interesting and really big things that maybe somebody has missed. I don't know. I'm really crap at segues, apparently. Anyway, Mike, you've got some really interesting stuff. Why don't you go ahead and take it away?
Well, what I'm talking about is SpaceX put out a tweet saying that they had conducted pressurization tests on their big liquid oxygen tank that's going to be for the interplanetary spaceship, the interplanetary transport system. And with this, they conducted the pressure test at sea last week. And this was actually in the state of Washington, in a little town called Anacortes. And we actually have video of the rollout of this, with them rolling out the tank to the ship that they were taking this out. And in their tweet, SpaceX said that they hit both of their pressure targets, and next up will be full cryo testing. What those pressure targets are, I don't know. There's a lot of theorizing on the r/SpaceX subreddit as to what that might be, and a lot of theories just showing that they just pressurized it with air instead of with liquid. But something that I do know is that Elon previously said that the liquid oxygen tank is the most difficult part of the interplanetary transport system spacecraft. So that's why they're tackling this first. That's why they built this first and are conducting these tests now to try to do it. So. Very interesting, and it's cool to see these updates and work actively being done on the interplanetary transport ship. And there it is out at sea right there, the photo from that was released in their tweet. So very cool. I'm very excited for more updates that SpaceX will hopefully give us.
It's kind of funny, though, because you see these teeny tiny little people, then it gets out on that whatever that bargey-looking thing is, and it doesn't look that big at that point. So it's like the perspective is very strange on
it
that.
It looks like a 5-gallon water jug that I could just like pick up, like, oh, I'm so thirsty from my run.
Right? Oh, we should have Vax 3D print us one of those just to have a ball, and that's what that is. Yeah. All right, so Pluto. The planet
Dwarf
Pluto?
Planet.
The planet Pluto?
Dwarf planet.
The planet Pluto?
Dwarf planet.
I have to represent Ben here. I'm sorry. There's something interesting about the planet Pluto?
Yeah, dwarf planet Pluto. So we've been talking about the fact that there might be a subsurface ocean underneath the ice on dwarf planet Pluto.
Uh-huh.
So we've continued to have more and more confirmation of this with the data as it comes back from New Horizons.
Sure.
Of course, New Horizons flew by Pluto in July of 2015. Only recently did we finally get all of the data downlinked from New Horizons, so still looking through all of this. Now, they look at Sputnik planatia, which is that heart-shaped feature there, especially when you look close up to it. This sort of cracking that you see in the ice plane is best explained by the uplift of a subsurface ocean pushing up against the ice that you see right there. Now, it's also aligned in an axis with Pluto's moon, Charon, and Charon allows allows that balance to happen. And when they try to run it through computer simulations, the only way they can get it to actually go into balance is to have a subsurface ocean right beneath where Charon would be sitting at. And Charon is right above that area right there. So there's a layer of convecting volatile ices on the top, so things like methane, carbon monoxide, and nitrogen ices. And it sits on top of a water ice-rich crust, which then below that has the subsurface liquid water ocean, and then a solid silicate core below that. So just more evidence that there's water everywhere in our solar system, and very, very fun stuff.
That is really fun stuff. Mm-hmm. All right, so one last story here, and this is a nice little update, I would like to say. Vector Space Systems has got some stuff going on. Mike, what have you got?
Yeah, who was on our show just a couple weeks ago.
Yeah.
They recently received a $1.25 million investment from the Space Angels Network,
Woo-hoo!
Which is a New York-based investment company that invests into space startups. And this is actually the first time that they've invested into a launch company, so that's very cool.
Yeah.
And with this, Vector Space also has about $2.25 million in contracts from the small business incentives from NASA as well as from DARPA. So with this, they are going to be on track to hopefully do their first launch in late 2017 to start launching small payloads, which they're looking at around 60 kilograms to low Earth orbit. So that's very exciting news that our guest who was on just a few weeks ago has gotten this update and will be able to move forward. I'm very excited for
it. We're totally going to take credit for that, right?
Yes.
Of course. Yeah,
right?
It wouldn't have happened.
Every time we talk about something, good things happen after that,
that's
right?
That's all we do here tomorrow.
Which will be even better because coming up next, Ben has got an interview with JP Aerospace, Mr. John Powell, joining us once again. He's been on the show one time before, but it was many years ago. A lot of fun things have happened, so that'll be very cool to catch up with that. So stay tuned. We'll be right back with that.
Look into her face, determination in her eyes. She won't give up or quit or fumble little fashion lies. Filled with awesome expectation. This girl's a fascination.
And welcome back to Tomorrow. My name is Benjamin Higginbotham. Now, before we get into our interview, I did want to give a shout out to all of the patrons of Tomorrow who have helped to make this specific segment of this episode happen. These are people who have contributed $10 or more. They get access to our Slack channel. We've also got a Tomorrow producers. These are people who have contributed $5 or more, and they're going to get access to international free shipping on our swag store. To find out how you can help crowdfund the shows of Tomorrow and get all those different levels of rewards, head on over to patreon.com/TMRO. All right, now, we are joined once again by John Powell of JP Aerospace. Thank you very much, John, for taking time out of your Saturday to join us. I know it's been a bit of a long day.
Oh, no problem.
So let's start off with, who is JP Aerospace? What are you guys doing?
Well, we're a small aerospace company. We consider ourselves a private space program. We just had our 38th anniversary this year as an organization since we incorporated in California. And we just got back last weekend from our 186th flight, where we flew a bunch of student payloads. We had 180 PongSat student experiments and 6 of the Minikube student experiments. And we did that run up to 95,000 feet on a high altitude balloon and had a nice flight. And then 2 weeks before that, we just flew our new airship, the Ascender 36. And so we've been doing a lot of flying and a lot of building and a lot of work in the shop we have a hypersonic wind tunnel, and we've been trying to get it to Mach 4 for a year and a half now. We're at Mach 3.8 and can't quite break that, but there's a lot going on.
So one of the things that you're doing a little bit differently, and actually we brought this up on a few shows a while ago, is you're doing balloons for the most part. So you're not doing giant vertical takeoff, vertical landing rockets or anything else like that. Your first stage is a balloon.
Oh, yeah. Our second, and our third stage is the balloon. We are the completely crazy airship to orbit guys. And we've been working on this project for literally decades now. We're the slowest space program in history, working out each technical problem as we go, to see if we can pull this off.
And what is Airship to Space? How does this, what is the plan?
Well, the simple idea, or the simple way to put it, is we take a lighter-than-air vehicle to 160,000 feet, you know, like balloons are flying to right now, and then we slowly start to accelerate it. So we take the, go to 60,000 feet, and then with a plasma propulsion system, slowly start to accelerate, and instead of over 6 minutes accelerating to orbit, we take up to 10 days to accelerate to orbit. But we start our acceleration and our orbital insertion at 400,000 feet, way above the atmosphere. Essentially, we want to change the whole nature of space travel by taking the rocket completely out of it.
But as was brought up in the chat room, I believe this is brought by Vogan, you can't fly a balloon to space. You know, those gases are going to expand. So how do you deal with it? There's a certain threshold that you just can't go over. How do you deal with that?
Well, actually, it's dynamic climb to orbit. Think of it as a giant flying wing. We actually are getting no buoyancy, or it's diminished buoyancy, and we're neutral at around 230,000 feet. And then that's when we actually begin to accelerate the vehicle, slowly climb. We don't even break Mach 1 until we're over 300,000 feet. Where, you know, they were taking balloons in the 60s, the Project Shotput balloons, they were flying them at Mach 10 at 300,000 to 400,000 feet. It's kind of our first goal is to replicate that old 60s technology and get our balloons going at Mach 10, or not quite, but almost halfway orbital velocity at 300,000 to 400,000 feet. So the question becomes, well, they could do that in the early 60s. Can we push it a little faster today? If with, you know, 40, 50 years more advanced technology, can we go to Mach 14 instead of Mach 10? Can we go to Mach 15? How far can you take that technology? And that's the question that we're trying to ask at JP Aerospace. I can't tell you if we can actually go Mach 22, but I can tell you it's an important enough question that somebody needs to find out. And that's what we're doing.
How fast have you gotten the system to go?
We've been, with the smaller vehicles, we've been up to Mach 3.5, but that's nothing as part of our bigger system at all. And that's not been driven with our primary engines, that's been driven with solids. Right now, you know, our biggest airship we built was a little bigger than a 747, and that was a custom build we did for the Air Force about 12 years ago, when we built a whole series of these big V-shaped airships for them. Our latest series, we built a 26-foot airship that we flew last year a couple of times, and then we're building we finished the 36-foot, the Ascender 36, and we flew that about 2 months ago now. And that one looks like this. Got prop. Have to have props.
And that was those were the blue balloons that we showed earlier, right? The giant blue. I think Dutta's got them coming up here. Here's one on the ground, right? You flew. Right, yeah. We saw pictures of this flying. This is what you flew you said a couple weeks ago.
Yeah. Well, that one's about a couple months ago. We just flew literally last weekend, but one of our conventional balloons that we fly our payloads on. And this one, even though it's smaller than the ones we built in the past, it's with all the new technology in it, the internal structure, the internal balloon lifting cells, the command and control system is completely different on these new smaller vehicles. And it's cheaper to test these on small vehicles than the really big vehicle.
So one of the questions from the chat room, or more of a comment, says, this is from SpaceCookie84, says, that's cool. So basically, you're waiting until most of the atmosphere is below you before you're putting the pedal to the metal. And you're not really putting the pedal to the metal. You're more kind of just very slowly continuing. You're just never letting go, right? You've got a very slow-moving vehicle, but you never let off the accelerator.
Exactly.
So based on that, go ahead.
The late 50s, early 60s, were just mylar balls. And they got these very thin mylar balls to go to Mach 10, and they didn't quite get all the way around the Earth. They didn't orbit, because they're only 400,000 feet at only Mach 10, but they were getting literally circling the Earth, and not just ballistically. So again, ours are a little sturdier and have their own propulsion rather than just be pushed by solids.
So one of the things Space Kyle mentions, Mach speed is relative to atmospheric pressure. More specifically, it's the speed of sound, which changes through atmospheric pressure and density. You're saying like Mach 10. Is that Mach 10 at sea level or at that altitude?
At sea level, Mach 10.
Okay.
As just a number to explain.
Sure.
Because the Mach number changes up there.
So using just kind of an absolute, will you be able to hit, are you targeting like the 17,500 mile per hour range? That's kind of generally considered, orbital velocity. That's the number you're trying to reach. But the question at this point is, can you reach that number with balloons? You know you can push them forward. It's just, can you make 17,500 miles an hour?
Yes, that's the question. And one of the big parts of it that we're doing in the lab is we're doing active drag reduction. Again, this is a lot of stuff that was in the lab in the 60s and 70s, and you can search and there's literally hundreds of IAAA papers on it, on electrically reducing drag by emitting plasma in front of the vehicle, breaking up the shockwave at hypersonic speeds. And right now, we really need to be getting to Mach 4 for that testing to really be valid. And we're doing a lot of our wind tunnel testing in the shop here. And we just got our wind tunnel, say we're at Mach 3.8, starting to do that kind of research, because even at 300,000 feet and 400,000 feet, you can get up close to where Alan Shepard went, there's still a lot of drag up there. And so we need to reduce the drag by about 40% to kind of close the loop to make that work. And in the 60s, they were getting 80 and 90% drag reductions on those systems. But those were in the lab, and we want to take those lab experiments and put it in the real world. And that's a whole different can of worms.
So what does it take to take those lab experiments and move them into the real world? Is it a funding issue, a time issue, a building issue? What do you need to get from A to B?
Well, next fall's mission. We fly about 5 missions every year. And we're all independently funded. We're crowdfunded. We do small contracts. We do a lot of TV commercials. We did Margarita in Space for National Margarita Day for Jose Cuervo. We did The Chair in Space.
Oh, I remember that. The Chair in Space, absolutely. Yeah,
And that's actually a full-size chair.
That's really cool.
What you don't see above the chair is the big balloon platform, these carbon booms coming down with IMAX cameras all around, filming all that. And even though we're just nickel and dime, just barely making it, we've never missed a mission or build a vehicle, never had a problem due to lack of funding.
So you mentioned crowdfunding as one of the things. Is that an active campaign like on Kickstarter, Patreon, something like that, or is it just kind of...
We don't have one going on now. We've done 2 successful Kickstarters, and we're ramping up for our third. We'll probably be starting that in about 4 months, because it takes a lot to put one of those together. And that's mainly to fund these, our PongSats. And we're actually the largest student payload program in the world. We've flown more student payloads by an order of magnitude than all the rest of the world's space programs combined. We've now flown, with this last mission last weekend, just over 18,000 student experiments.
Oh, wow.
It's about 75 to 80,000 students have participated. And on this last vehicle, in fact, the one in the picture there, there was about 480 student experiments. And some are real simple, little marshmallows that puff up in vacuum or plant seeds. And some of them had GPSs and cameras. We had one that had a GPS, a camera, and he was taking pictures every 10 seconds and then altitude stamping each of the pictures as he went. And then it also had cubes, like CubeSats. We have a smaller version called the Mini Cube, and this is one from Eastern Florida State University, and it flew on the last mission. This is a double stack cube, because there's a cube here and a cube there, and it's got a whole range of sensors and doing their experiments, and we fly a lot of these. The PongSats were always free. In fact, most of the money doesn't go into the Airship to Orbit program. Most of the money from the TV commercials pays for flying ping pong balls. But the universities pay for flying the cubes, and that also helps pay for the CubeSats. And then on each of these missions, even though they have all these education payloads on, there's five or six airship orbit experiments. So anything that goes on an airship before it flies on the airship will have flown to the edge of space a dozen times on one of the balloon vehicles, just testing it and doing shakedown. So this is a big, giant, crazy program with these big, giant, crazy ideas. But literally every couple of months, we're doing the flights, flying the missions, crossing one more impossible thing off the list.
So it sounds like you're using the balloon missions and the PongSats and the very small CubeSat missions as a way to test out the technology for your airship to orbit stuff. Then once you get airship to orbit, kind of working and moving faster and actually making it into orbital speeds, what's kind of the game plan there? Is that something that helps reduce the cost of objects to orbit? I mean, what does the advantage of airship to orbit get me?
Oh, we want to change the whole nature of space travel. Right now, it's like, to use the shuttle as an example, except for right near the end, if you had an engine out, they call it LOC, or loss of crew event. There are so many things that are loss of crew event. With the airship to orbit, say you're right in the middle of the final orbital insertion burn, and your engine conks out, or anywhere on there. Well, you go have a meeting about it. It's not like you have to make everything right and save the crew in the next 4 seconds or everybody's dead. You have a meeting about it, you talk to the people on the ground, you have a big conference call, wait a couple hours, you go work in the back, tear down the engine, see if you can fix it. And if you can't fix it, you float back down. And the idea is that, what if you took off in your 747 and everyone in the control tower, every time it took off, everyone jumped up and cheered, oh, thank God everybody made it. You wouldn't want to fly on 747s. But that's what happens every time we fly astronauts to space. The moment the rocket engine shuts down, everybody jumps up and cheers and cries because they didn't kill everybody. We want to change that. And also, it's a completely reusable system. Right now, transatlantic travel is 5 cents per ton mile by container ships, and a modern container ship is an amazingly sophisticated vehicle. Not quite as sophisticated as a space shuttle, but pretty complex in its own right. We want to bring not the $1,000 a pound, the mythical $1,000 a pound from the $10,000 a pound. We want to bring it down to dollars per ton mile, just like cargo is.
How large do you need to make the airship to bring it, to make that vision a reality?
Oh, these are huge vehicles. And remember, they're also inflatable vehicles, so size, you know, it's like we built one vehicle that was a little bigger than a 747, but only weighed 630 pounds. And that's the total vehicle and engine weight. We're talking about a vehicle, our primary test vehicle that we're eventually going to build, is 6,000 feet long. You know, it's literally over a mile long airship.
So it's a giant airship. You can put humans on it. You can put cargo on it. Once you figure out the velocity part of it, right? So you're still testing. Mm-hmm. You're not quite there yet, but working towards it. You mentioned one of the factors is safety. And certainly chemical engines are, and even solids are scary, right? I mean, it's a controlled explosion, which you don't really have. But you are on a giant balloon. And that balloon can, and this is a bit of a harsh term, but it could pop. I mean, you could lose the structure of the balloon, could you not? Would that not be catastrophic?
No. It's like our current airships. It looks like it's one big vehicle. If you did a cutaway, it's actually a series of smaller balloons all up and down those arms. And we can lose up to 3 balloons in flight and not even abort the mission. We lose the 4th balloon in flight, and then we do have to not catastrophically fall, but abort the mission and fly down and land.
So you have a point where even if you start losing structure, you can go, okay, well, we've lost too much structure. We abort at this point, and you come back, and that's that.
Yeah.
Assuming you don't continue to lose structure on your way back down.
Oh, yeah. Well, if the whole thing breaks up and it falls apart and explodes, then everybody gets out. But so many things would have to happen for that. Like on the big one that we built for the Air Force, the 175-foot, on the top was 6 14-inch diameter vents for venting helium. At 100,000 feet, those vents have to be open for about 45 minutes, all 6 of them, before you can detect descent.
Oh, wow.
So say you had a meteor hit you and left a big hole. Well, the real trick isn't that you're falling to your doom. The real trick is detecting that that event has happened. Because the pressures are near vacuum, the flow rate across there is so low. If you have the meteor storm and you had six of them, well, you know, in 45 minutes, you're going to be starting down. And what you do at the time, if you detect that, you pump the remaining helium from those cells into the adjacent cells. And you definitely abort the mission if you have a whole bunch of holes from meteors in you.
It's an interesting concept, right? Because you don't have the chemical engine reaction, so you're not worried about that. It sounds like you have some redundancy in structure. I mean, nothing's foolproof, but you've got a good chunk of redundancy in structure. So then it's just a matter of and how are you re-entering, right? Because one of the problems is you're going 17,500 miles an hour. You're going to slam into atmosphere, and you're going to want to burn up. Do you just?
Do our deceleration up high instead of down low. Re-entry temperature is really based on wing loading, or surface area to mass. Surface area to mass determines, you know, your temperature load and your heat load. The 6,000-foot vehicle, the max reentry temperature is right around 71 degrees. So, in fact, the drag, even in orbit, the drag is so high you have to keep the engines on. You're truly not in a free orbit. Literally, you're flying up there, you get to orbit, you have to release your payload or deploy the payload. And then to reenter, you're not doing a reentry burn. You're literally throttling down. And the drag pulls you back down.
So let's go back to some questions from the chat room. One of them comes from Sane Alex, which asks about those engines. Are they going to be solar-powered plasma? Or basically, what's your fuel for that?
They're actually hybrid engines. They're not in the... Well, only partially in the sense of the chemical engine, liquid oxygen, and a solid fuel. They're hybrid in the sense of half plasma engine, half chemical engine. And in a sense, you have, in a chemical engine, the combustion chamber is where the fire is, where the plasma is. We're actually using that plasma from a chemical reaction to accelerate, and then accelerating that magnetically like a traditional plasma engine. So it's half chemical engine, half plasma engine. People haven't looked at this kind of engine before because you could think of it as the world's worst ion engine. Huh. You know, traditional ion engine, they have a thing called ISP, which is kind of a function of performance. You know, they're getting 60, 70,000 ISP, just amazing on these quad-staged ion engines. But they can barely lift a piece of paper up off the ground. So they're basically for orbital things. And then you have your chemical engines that have ISPs in the 350 range, or the shuttle, which was the best ever, in the 400 range. But they burn all their fuel in moments. And you can't really throttle them down. You can, but you throttle them down and your ISP tanks. You can't really run a shuttle engine, you know, just barely on slow. So what this engine is, it's a small chemical engine. And then the chemical engine creates the ions, or the plasma. And an ion engine, that's actually quite a bit of the power, electrical power requirement, is in that creation of the ions. We actually do away with that power requirement by using the chemical engine to do that. And then on the backside, it's what's referred to as either a mixed ion gas or non-mixed equilibrium ion gas, or dirty ion engine, then as a plasma engine to accelerate that plasma. The reason it's a terrible engine, it's either the world's worst chemical engine because it can't even lift itself off the ground, or it's the world's worst ion engine because instead of 60,000 ISP, it only has 1,000 ISP. You'd only need this if, say, you had a steamship going across the Atlantic and you need an engine that would chuck along for 9 days and give you a reasonable amount of thrust. Well, that's what we have. We have the airship lifting that until we get really high and start dynamically climbing. So it's an engine that has no use on the planet except for our purposes. And we actually have a pretty vigorous engine program. And we've done about 119 firings so far, just all very small scale. And we've done 4 flights. We're actually, our test stand for our engines are at 100,000 feet, because we do fire them off on platforms from our Hyrax. We have Pongsats below, rocket engines firing off the top. And that's actually coming along really well, and we're starting to scale up our engines. And we've now cannot fire the engines in our parking lot anymore, because the last one set off some car alarms a few blocks away, made lots of noise. We just recently now have our own facility up in northern Nevada. The last couple of launches we did was from, call it the Area 42, because it's 42 acres, or the JP Aerospace Advanced Research Facility, which is a fancy way of saying big plot of land with a cargo container on it. And that's where the next round, probably in January, of the engine firing tests will be taking place.
So, dumb question on your chemical rockets. You know, one of the disadvantages of a traditional rocket is it's the chemical reaction is a controlled explosion. It's a very large,
yes,
very powerful controlled explosion. And if you lose even a little bit of that control, it's a very bad day. But if you're using chemical rockets on your vehicle, how is that any different?
Oh, one thing, it's a lot smaller. And we're burning at a much lower rate than you would. It's more akin to a jet engine firing than it is to a rocket engine firing. But that risk is there. It doesn't completely vanish.
And then, so you're using these engines. The other disadvantage of a chemical engine is you're going to expend your fuel at some point. You're 10 days to orbit, so are you bringing like huge vats of fuel, or do you only need a little bit? Like, how does your fuel work for a 10-plus-day mission?
Actually, the chemical part of the engine is also a hybrid, where the fuel is a solid and the oxidizer is liquid. So it's really cartridge-based. And these engines are long. The engine is about 300 feet long. It's more akin to a linear accelerator that you keep a flame going inside than a rocket engine. And then it's also cartridge-based.
And so right now...
Fuel the rocket, you have to literally open up the engine and replace all the cartridges between flights.
You mentioned your oxidizer. What are you using for your oxidizer? Is it liquid oxygen, something else?
Well, for what we're doing right now, we're doing nitrous and acrylic, and we're moving to nitrous in the spring and paraffin, enhanced paraffin, paraffin with magnesium particles in it. We don't see that being combination as being the final one. There's a lot of candidates for it. But like I say, we're still, right hip deep in the development process. I'm thinking it's probably going to be a LOX, paraffin, and magnesium combination. But that's, we won't really know for a couple more years.
This question comes from Green Jim 2, which is, we talked about this 10 days to orbit. Traditional rockets have launch windows measured in seconds or minutes because they're trying to, make a particular orbit and you have to pass by it at a certain time. What does a 10-day orbit launch have as a launch window? Is it the same kind of you need to get moving?
You have
or
huge, huge adjustable launch window because you can accelerate, decelerate. We want to be in kind of the middle window. So if we need to drop down to 12-day insertion, we can make that change in flight or accelerate up to an 8-day insertion if we need to. So we don't have those real tight, narrow windows like a traditional rocket would.
And how far does this scale? We're about to see the GOES-R launch in, an hour from now or so. Would you be able to take that satellite eventually up to its intended orbit?
Well, there's the eventual vehicle. Our eventual dream vehicle is the 6,000-foot vehicle. Now, our initial vehicle demonstrator for actually reaching orbit is only 1,800 feet, baby 1,800-foot long vehicle. And that one will only carry a couple hundred pounds to orbit. Our eventual goal with the 6,000-foot vehicle that we're kind of scaling everything around is 60,000 pounds to orbit, to LEO.
Destructor 1701
space station's intact to orbit.
Destructor 1701 asks, at the end of the day, for your 6,000-foot vehicle, fully laden, how long would it take to get, for example, to the International Space Station type orbit? Because assuming you have enough power, you could go anywhere you want.
Well, ideally, this vehicle will just take payload to LEO, to minimum LEO orbits, and OTV, orbital transfer vehicle, is really the ideal vehicle for taking it up to the station. You wouldn't want to drag this big airship and all that infrastructure up from LEO to a station altitude. So we're not really shooting for that. We're just kind of giant bulk cargo to LEO.
But you could take bulk cargo that then from LEO launches itself up to the International Space Station.
That's exactly it. That's exactly it.
So would someone else develop those vehicles? You're basically saying, hey, look, we've got this big, huge thing. And then you go to, say, Sierra Nevada, for example, and say, hey, we'll get you really high up and going at really good velocity if you can make it the rest of the way there.
Oh, exactly. We'd love to develop that top half vehicle. But doing that on top of doing all of this, I think it would be a bit too much. It's almost like, what if we don't pull this off? Say we only get back to what they did in 1962, and we got to Mach 10 at 400,000 feet. That makes an awesome air launch vehicle to fire a rocket on top of. What if we do a little better, and we get to Mach 15 at 500,000 feet? Suddenly, a Falcon 1 fired from there is like a Falcon Heavy. And that's if we don't make it. That's
the,
our...
The other thing we can look at is once you're at those speeds and those payloads, you could use it simply as a refueling architecture for traditional rockets. So we want to go to Mars, for example. You know, we need to bring fuel depots up to space. What is a cheap, easy way to just bring giant fuel tanks up there where we can refuel? This might be an interesting way to do that. It gets you a good chunk of the way there, and then maybe a couple solids on the sides brings it the rest of the way to where it needs to be.
Yeah. Because, you know, air launch is getting more and more popular, where it's kind of, it comes and goes, you know, with Virgin Galactic and I don't know why I don't remember their name right now, with a giant double 747.
Stratolaunch,
yes. And they're talking about flying from about Mach 0.8 from 50,000 feet for their air launch. They're great people, but that's wimpy air launch. Air launch should be 500,000 feet at Mach 17. That's air launch.
Destructor 1701 also asks, what sort of materials challenges do the 1,800 and 6,000 square foot vehicles present in terms of stresses?
The conventional stresses that you look in spacecraft design are well handled with those materials. There's actually some exotic stresses that are the real challenges. Because this is a flexible membrane surface, you get this phenomenon called hypersonic flutter. And usually in like X-15 and hypersonic craft, you have flutter issues on the rudder and on the horizontal stabilizers. We actually have the problem of hypersonic flutter on across the surface of the vehicle. And that's one of the really extreme design challenges that we're trying to model in our hypersonic wind tunnel to start to get a handle on. Because if you don't have a handle on it, there's no known material. You know, you can make your thing out of concrete encased in steel, encased in titanium, but if you have hypersonic flutter, it's not enough. So it's really, you can't handle it, you can't solve it through a materials solution, unfortunately. You have to solve it through a management of the load issues. I mean, the solution has to lie there.
All right, just a couple more questions. This one comes from Citizen 12708, which is, why don't you put these firings on YouTube? The rocket engine firings, I think he was referring to.
I have about 20 of them up there. We do.
They want more. They want more. They want them all live. Yeah. Everyone wants everything.
I haven't got the videos from the last airship up there yet. I have to get these. Whenever we do the Pongsats, all the kids get a documentary of their mission so they can see their ping pong balls. And so we're in heap deep of making that. But I think I have like a dozen firings on YouTube. Again, these are all very small. They're not very big. These are little engines. And we've just scaled them up to be too scary to be standing next to when they fire, which is why we have to move out to the desert to do them. So those videos will be more fun, because more fire, more flame.
Hopefully controlled the whole
hopefully
time.
Hopefully controlled.
Jim Burr asks, what's the speed of those launchers? What's the cost per small sat launch?
For
yeah,
what
let's
we're
say,
doing now?
Let's say a citizen wants to bring up a Pong sat or, one of the small CubeSats or something like that.
CubeSats are completely free. We don't charge anything, and we do thousands every year. These guys, this is our double cube. There is two, you can buy them in pairs, and then when you buy them in pairs, they're a little cheaper, but they're $340, and you get the cube and the flight for the $340. Now, we also just, in fact, we announced it today, we've never had this before. Our new cube is called the Arduino cube, and it's elongated, so you can put an Arduino board in there. And the Arduino boards, or Arduino cubes, are going to be $440. And that includes the cube and the flight of the cube. All right. And we just flew our Arduino cube on this last mission.
Last question before we go into the, we've got a little rapid fire thing we're going to do. And this comes from Space and this is during the last interview, which I think was about 6 years ago or so, you mentioned high altitude propeller design. Are you still working with propellers at all?
We did that. We pulled it off. We made the world's only tested high-altitude propeller. Then afterwards, the Helios people did that. Ours performs a little bit better, but they spent over $1 billion on it, and we spent about 6,000 on it. Huh. And that's part of the project we did for the Air Force. And those drive all our... We've set the world altitude record for airships only 2 years ago. Oh, 4 years ago. Time flies. With our tandem airship. And those are 6-foot blades. And we flew it to 95,000 feet, flew it around. And those propellers were on that vehicle, and they're on our airships that we're flying now.
I'm just going to mirror something that Destructor 1701 said, which is, you're awesome. I love how far outside of the box you're thinking.
Thank you.
It's really cool to see new innovative ways. The fact that you're I would say, normally we say bending metal, but you're not really bending metal. You're more like stitching balloons. I don't know what phrase to use there, but
taping a lot of things together.
There you go. You're making hardware. You're actually flying things. And, a lot of the traditional aerospace people might go, well, that's not space. Well, it's not space yet, right? So once you get those velocities up, yeah.
The really weird thing is it used to be space. When the X-15 program was going on, this huge titanic argument that would get really heated between scientists whether space began at 70,000 feet or 100,000 feet. By the time they ended the X-15 program, the 100,000-foot guys won, absolutely. And they finally got support of the pilots when they started flying above that.
Huh.
But then it got declared when they got in that fight with NASA and the Air Force that it began at 50 miles, so the X-15 guys didn't count. That's more of a political thing than a science thing, but officially it's near space.
Doesn't matter. You're working on stuff. You're working on stuff to go faster and faster, and you continue to iterate on the design. And it's very cool that you're actually building things and making stuff happen. And I'm excited to see what comes of that. We were all excited with the balloon castles, I think is what it was referred to, and we thought it was just really cool. All right. These are a few questions that we ask all of our guests now. You can have really short answers. This is just, there are no right or wrong answers. All right. So the first question is, Moon or Mars first?
Venus.
Good answer. Liquid or solid propellant?
Hybrid chemical electric propellant.
What should the name of the first vehicle going to Mars be?
Anything but calling it Mars. Or one of the variations are like Ares or...
Sure.
Just something besides calling the Mars mission Mars.
When do you think humans will first land on Mars?
Oh, I'd say we're a solid 20 out.
20 years.
I think we're going back to the moon first.
Interesting. So
that would be
first.
My bet. If I had to put a dollar down, I would love it to happen sooner. But I think we're 20 years out. I think we're going to get close, and then we're going to zoom over to the moon.
That ties to my next question quite well. When do you think humans will set foot on the moon again?
Oh, I said within 10 years.
Interesting.
Maybe within 8 years.
And why space?
Because I want to go.
All right, great answers. John, where can people find more information about you and JP Aerospace if they want to keep up to date with you?
I try to post pictures on our Facebook site every day. I get to our blog, and you can search for us JP Aerospace on Facebook. We also have a Twitter account that we post about every other day. the blog we post at jpurospace.com right across the top. Click on the blog. I get to that about once a week.
Absolutely awesome. All right, John, thank you so much for taking time out of your Saturday. We really appreciate you coming back on the show. What you're doing is really, really cool. Hopefully the Space Angels Network was watching this show too. All right, we're going to take a quick break. And when we come back, comments from last week's show. Stay tuned. We'll be right back.
We've always looked to the stars. They guide us, give us comfort, help us find our way. We see ourselves out there. When we look up, it inspires us. And we long for something we don't yet know. We yearn to go there. So, we venture forth.
We choose to go to the moon in this decade and do the other thing. Not because they are easy, but because they are hard. Because that goal will serve to organize and measure the best of our energies and skills.
Tranquility Base here. The Eagle has landed. It's one small step for man.
The exploration of space will go ahead, whether we join in it or not.
Many think we stopped exploring. But we know our journey didn't end. We've only just begun.
Orion is functioning perfectly at this point.
Come with us and explore tomorrow.
And welcome back, everyone. Glad to have you still watching. Now, before we head off to the comments, we first want to thank all of our patrons of tomorrow. These, of course, are our tomorrow premiere members who give us $10 or more. We've also got our tomorrow producers who give us $5 or more. But wait, we've also got our tomorrow plus subscribers. These folks give us $2.50 or more, and they get early access to After Dark and the actual live show itself. And then, of course, we cannot forget our tomorrow Patreon patrons themselves. They give us up to $2.49, and they get their name in the show and access to Google Hangouts. And if you would like to be a patron of tomorrow, head on over to patreon.com/TMRO.
I think you guys are going to love what we're doing in Orbit 10. And
yes,
that's all thanks to Patreon. So
yes,
it was a game changer for this show. Mm-hmm. And I realize sometimes in our comments, people are like, oh, they something, something Patreon too much. And I don't feel like throwing the slates up on the screen for 60 seconds is too much.
It's not even, especially if you're somewhere in the middle, it's sort of like, I mean, there I am.
Other than our own ads that we put in the middle, the launch calendar and the little promo video, which I'll try to make a shorter version for Orbit 10. And we only put those in there because we need a point to, like a change point in the show.
Mm-hmm.
Other than that, there are no ads in the show. You don't see pop-ups. You shouldn't see pop-ups. You shouldn't see other rolled ads.
Mm-hmm.
The only thing that supports this show are the patrons. And
yes,
so, you know,
that's it.
That's it. And so thank you guys for making that happen. And if you don't like the patronage stuff, then
you guys are a huge support.
Yes.
And actually, if you don't like it or if you can't do it, the other way to support the show that really does help, subscribe on YouTube and tell people about it.
Mm-hmm.
Right? Because the more people that watch the show, the higher our numbers, the more clout we have with organizations like Google and YouTube and whatnot to help, you know, show up higher in the rankings. So simply clicking subscribe helps a great deal.
Yeah, sharing it with all of your friends.
All right, let's get started with some comments from our last week's show. Capcom, take us away.
So,
no, I'm calling you Janet from now on. Are you Janet?
No, goodness, no. No, Capcom is fine.
Did we explain Janet? We'll explain Janet after that.
Anyway.
Yeah.
So last week's show was talking about Vector Aerospace, so that's...
Wait, was Vector last week, or did we have...
Oh, no, you're right.
Yeah, we had Trump Space, which was...
You're right.
We didn't update the rundown. Yeah.
We did not update the rundown, and like Ron Burgundy, I just read whatever was in front of me.
I'm Ron Burgundy.
So there's that. Thank you. Data is currently changing it in the chat room, or in the rundown. Yep, Trump Space. There you go. Now I can read it correctly.
Jeff Faust. We had Jeff Faust on.
Thank you. Yes. Goodness. So the first comment comes off of YouTube. This one comes from Jazz Throwout. It says, Carrie Ann asking questions helps animate and explain the news segment, but on the other hand, it is a bit cringeworthy, even for me as a man, to see a woman on the team acting dumb and having the guys mansplain everything to her.
I don't think that's fair. So
it's not fair, and it's not fair for a couple of reasons. Like, if I may,
sure.
For just a moment. The very, very, very short story of how this ever even remotely came to be is we previously had a different podcast. We wanted to continue to do a podcast. We wanted to do it in a slightly different way, have a different topic as it were. Ben suggested space. I said that was the dumbest thing I've ever heard of. He said, well, as soon as we have nothing else to talk about with space, we'll stop doing the podcast. I said, great. Here we are. We're about to enter into year number 10. So I very much so knew nothing. I knew there was space. I knew there were people in space.
It was up.
And sincerely, that's about it. I was born in 77. I missed the Apollo program. I did see some of the space shuttle program. And I distinctly remember sitting down in my classroom and watching Challenger not exist anymore. And that's about it. I wasn't interested. I didn't care. But Ben was. And he kind of said, all right, well, I know some things and you don't know some things. And we kind of went into it with this whole idea of Ben knows some things and I don't. And so I get to be the outsider and I get to ask questions and say, okay, well, but why do I care about that? And it's kind of continued along that way. I've learned a lot. Don't get me wrong. I'm actually a very big fan now. I really get connected to human spaceflight because there's another human there that I can interact with.
But I don't think you're asking questions that are like, I already know the answer to this, right? You're not playing dumb on the show.
Right. I want to be very clear about that. I'm not really playing dumb. There's a lot about planetary science I really don't understand.
Oh, me too.
And there's quite a bit about rockets that I can't tell the difference between them. I'm sorry. I
They're
don't.
They're not all the same, Carrie-Anne.
Right. But right. Exactly. They look alike. Don't start. But I feel as though in any industry, there's a lot of that kind of thing. You know, people ask me all the time, what's the difference between a latte and a cappuccino? Well, I mean, well, they are basically the same, but they're a little bit different. And I don't feel as though it's a dumb question. And I take joy in being able to educate and explain that to somebody who doesn't understand and get them to a point where they do understand so we can all be speaking the same language and we can all understand and learn together. And that's what the concept of the show has always been from the very beginning. And yes, it just happens to be that I'm the female here. But, you know, you can look at Lisa on her space pods. She blows me away. She's smarter than the rest of us, honestly, and she's funny, yeah. Too. you know, I learn a lot from everybody on the show, and my role here has always been to be the person to kind of poke at things a little bit and say, but I don't why do I care about a weirdly shaped meteorite on Mars? I kind of felt stupid asking the question, but I felt confident enough to ask the question so that I could get an answer. Does that help?
Yeah, and Jazz is in the chat room, says, I didn't entirely mean that seriously, guys, either. But I think it's a valid thing to bring up because, Jazz, you weren't the only one that said something.
Right.
Yeah.
So I think it's important to understand that we're not mansplaining things to Carrie-Anne and that good engineers ask those questions. And if you just sit and pretend like you know everything, that's what makes a bad engineer. And so, male or female, it doesn't matter. Asking questions about things you don't understand, it will help explain it. And I'm of the opinion that while we have a great deal of rocket scientists on the show who understand everything that you say, I'll be frank, I don't understand everything you say. Or everything that you say, I don't understand everything you say either. We have a lot of people who do understand everything. We have more people, in my opinion, we have more people who didn't understand something or with a little bit of different context will understand it a little bit better. And I think that is the role, as you so eloquently put it, that you bring to the show. Mm-hmm. And I don't want to change that. And we've been playing with news to try to make it fit. And I think we're really starting to hit something that works. And I really like it, but I want to make sure that the community understands it's not us shoehorning you into that. And I don't know how to make it not look that way yet.
Right. And will freely admit a couple of people have been complimenting me on my new role in the new segment, and I appreciate that. I am still learning my way. I'm still becoming comfortable with who I am on camera, particularly when I'm not just telling Ben that he's wrong, if you will.
Yes.
And that's where I am. And so hopefully you guys are a little patient with me, and I'm a little patient with me, quite frankly. And, you know, we're going to go through these growing pains together, but it's going to be okay.
Citizen Big Number does bring up a point, which is mansplaining is condescending, and I'm not getting that vibe. And hopefully not, because we're not, yeah, we're not meaning anything condescending. We all of us, you guys included, love and adore space and think that humans' future is in space. And we want to share that excitement. And the best way to share that excitement is through education. And people who ask questions and say, I don't understand, we will take the time and not mock you and yes, help you understand what you don't understand. To us, it might be a simple question, but if you don't get it, we're more than happy and excited to help you learn. And I think that's why the show is here. I think it's fun and exciting and engaging. That's why we have a live chat room, so you can ask your questions in real time. That's what we're about. And so hopefully that comes across. And Jazz, I didn't mean to throw you under the bus that way. I'm sorry.
That also wasn't the intention.
It wasn't the intent to throw Jazz under the...
It was a pretty concise way of wording what other people also said.
It was. It was a very concise comment, pulling it all together. And I wanted to make sure that everyone understood my thought process on it, certainly your thought process on it, because mm-hmm, it's more important what you think about that, and then kind of why the show is like that. So, and if we find a better way to do it, we'll do it in a better way. Right? So,
yeah, I mean,
all right, cool.
As we're figuring this out, as long as we're all respectful to each other, there's no problem. And just like you said, we haven't been condescending towards each other. That's the important part, I think.
Actually, yes, that's what I love about the community of TMRO is we do follow rule number 3 to the T, almost always, which is debate the idea, not the person, which means we are respectful to the other people. We may completely and totally disagree with their assessment, but we always respect the person mm-hmm, because, frankly, we could be wrong, too. And that's part of it is in some of these really out there theoretical things, we just don't know. Yeah. You know, JP Aerospace is one of those where it's easy to look at that and be condescending. But if you actually just stop for a moment, take a look at it, you go, actually, this is one of the more brilliant things I've ever heard. And mm-hmm, you don't want to necessarily be on the wrong side of that. Yeah. So that's why we always want to. Anyhow, I just derailed us. All right, next up, Capcom.
Next comment also comes off of YouTube. This one comes from Marnix Jansen.
Hi, Marnix.
Bye. Hey, Marnix.
A really great name, actually. I'm now 15 minutes in and bored out of my skull. It's probably my fault, sorry. Maybe because I'm not an American, but mostly because you're making me eat my veggies first. Please put the news first and the comments last, so the dry, boring stuff is sandwiched between the fun and short tidbits.
Oh, that hurts me. It hurts me. Basically, what Marnix is saying is that you guys are interesting, my interview segments are boring, and then this is interesting again. That's if I were to sum up that comment, I'm boring, you guys are interesting.
Why are you still talking? I don't understand.
Wait. This is rule number 5. Ben is always right. This is,
yeah, as Dutta saying, rule. Oh, wait. Did you do that on your new feature where you talk to everyone? Everyone can hear Dutta now.
Dutta.
Say hi, Dutta.
Hi, Dutta.
So one of the downsides of having audio glitches before the show, which we'll explain in After Dark, is that when we fixed it all, I just fixed it all at once. All right, we did that as a, I realize we've been playing with the show a lot recently, yet last week's show was different in that the news of the Trump administration of what's happening to NASA was bigger than any of the individual news segment inside of that show. And so we moved that to the front because it was the bigger, more important thing.
Yes.
And that will happen from time to time when we have guests on that have relevant topics that are hyper sensitive at that moment in time, but very rarely, I think, is what's going to happen there. I agree, the proper show format is news. There's something fun about news and getting you started, then the interview, and then the comments section.
That's
and
why we normally do it that way.
That's why we normally do it that way. And then also, we've been pulling the interview segment out and posting it as its own thing. So if you don't want the news or the comments and you're just interested in, say, JP Aerospace and, you know, balloons to orbit, or airships to orbit, excuse me, you can watch just that. That's the plan moving forward. We're not going to be changing that plan. We'll be tweaking kind of how each one of them interacts with the other thing, but that remains as is. And hopefully you don't actually think the interview segments are boring. You hurt me. Marnix, you hurt me.
Well,
right here.
If I may.
Don't say they're boring. Don't say they're boring.
If I may, I took this question from, or this comment from Marnix Jansen, not to say that he thought the interview segment was boring, but that that particular topic, since he's not an American, was boring to him, that he could care less about the election. That's what I got out of that.
I understand that, but keep in mind, approximately, I forgot what the latest number is, but it's going to say somewhere around 50%. It's like 49% of private, non-military space. 49% of that budget is in NASA worldwide. Yeah. So if you take the rest of the world's non-military budget and combine it, you basically equal just NASA. And so what happens to NASA is important to the rest of the world, to all of humanity. Now, that may change. I would love to see ESA match NASA's budget.
Yeah.
Wouldn't that be awesome? And if ESA did that, I guarantee you, the first segment of that show is going to be someone able to talk about what's happening with ESA and how they're matching or exceeding NASA's budget, because that's a big deal. And so when you mess with something of that size, we're going to bring it on. We're going to do it first. And you know, it impacts everything. It impacts commercial crew. It impacts the cargo to the station, which impacts the abilities for these companies to do some of their R&D stuff. Uh-huh. It touches everything. So yeah, it's a little, people get sick of politics, but if you're really passionate about space, you have to pay attention to this stuff too. Yep. It directly impacts what we are passionate about.
Yeah, and what we work in too.
Yes, I mean, absolutely.
That's a very important thing. You got to remember, a lot of space flight, even though commercial space flight is coming up, there's still a lot of stuff that's federally or governmentally funded. So mm-hmm. It's still a major factor of just straight up employment for some of us on this show.
Good chunk of us.
Yeah.
All right, next up, Capcom.
Next up comes off of YouTube as well. This is from Joseph Habdank.
Habdank.
One of those has got to be close. Okay. I think it is possible that Trump could try to increase funding for space exploration. I think sending humans to the moon or Mars could be a grand goal that would be in line with making America great again. Plus, space programs can easily become jobs programs, and it seems he will be leaning towards increasing spending. I'm cautiously optimistic at this point.
One could make the argument that the greatest America was the one that went to the moon. Right? That is one of the greatest accomplishments humans have ever had.
Good accomplishment.
Sure.
I don't know if a lot of things that were happening around that time, maybe socially, were like.
Okay,
some
so
of the
socially,
best.
It was a horrible time.
Socially, not the best time ever. Technologically.
We want the technological part of it back.
Yes.
Without all the social stuff. But it seems like we're getting them both, whether we want it or not.
It feels like we're regressing socially, anyways. So.
Yeah. We're getting a double dose.
Something I've noticed, too, is he keeps saying, let's make America great again. But no one's asked him, what does that mean? What does it mean? When was America great to you? What does that even mean to you, Mr. Trump?
Yeah,
so
that's a real...
I would like that explained.
That's a real personal kind of question that ends up showing off a lot of scruples and things from the person you ask it to. So.
But it could potentially mean good things for... It's too early.
We
just don't know. But, I was thinking about, one of the best moments in history was us landing on the moon, was us, humanity, landing on the moon. And if we want to look at, past things that were great, that was a great thing. You're right, though. The social construct around it was terrible.
Yeah, it was
like,
awful.
And we definitely don't want that part back.
Yeah, we would rather not. It's just not.
Yeah, exactly. All right.
This wasn't good.
Let's see here.
Looks like we have... Two or three more?
No, we're going to... last comment.
Oh. You want me to do this one as the last comment?
Yeah, next one is the last comment.
Yeah?
Stuart. Okay. Stuart.
Perfect. Last comment comes off of YouTube as well. From a Stuart Young. Mr. Stuart. Yay! Eileen Collins for NASA Administrator. And let's bring back the National Space Council. Only let's name it the National Council of Astronautics after the books or movies 2001 and 2010. And the International Lunar Station materializes. It can be coordinated by the International Lunar Commission, borrowing that name, of course, from the Authority Moonbase Alpha from the 1970s sci-fi show, Space 1999. Okay, I just really geeked out there for a moment. Just excuse me.
It would be fun to sci-fi. You know, it is amazing how much sci-fi influences sci-fa? Science fact.
Science fiction. Science fact.
Yeah, influences. Well, I mean, even looking at like phones and communication, and they're trying to build tricorders. And you know, this comment basically saying, "Hey, you know."
So Starfleet Academy, what?
Starfleet Academy. I am moderately convinced.
Noticed that most of these space agencies around are using the logo from Star Trek as their logo. I mean, Space Command is using the Starfleet logo right now.
It would be kind of cool to build the actual Starfleet where Star Trek says it goes in San Francisco. Yeah, I mean,
it would make sense because of Silicon Valley being there.
The grounds are beautiful up there.
Yeah. So I just,
you can go and there's like a plaque. It's like future home thereof.
Maybe we
which
need,
is awesome.
Maybe we need to start a Kickstarter to actually create Starfleet in its actual home in San Francisco. I want to know what you guys think.
What should our goal be?
I don't know how much that would. I don't know what
$5 billion.
Well, no. How many gold plus platinum?
Gold pressed
platinum. That's what I said. Gold
that's
pressed.
That's not what you said.
I may have slurred some of those words together, but that's what
said,
I meant.
How many bars of gold pressed platinum?
Yeah, exactly.
All right.
We're not at that point yet, though.
Well, maybe we should be, Jared. Maybe we should be. All right. That's our show. We've got a couple comments left. We're going to take care of those in After Dark. I'd like to thank everyone so much for watching. Next week is the American holiday, Thanksgiving, and we've got family over. You guys are out. You guys are out. So no show. We just were like, all right, we're not going to.
Eating and off-roading, basically.
Eatingandoffroading.com.
Yep. Yeah, that's my brand. So,
Jared at eatingandoffroading.com. Fantastic, Jared. Thank you. All right. So we're off the air next week. Then we're back on for, is it 2 or 3 weeks? I don't remember. We're back on for a couple
three
of
weeks.
December. And then at the end of December, we'll be off for a couple of weeks as we transition over to Orbit 10. So I'd like to thank everyone so much for watching, and we'll see you in 2 weeks.